all. So why I chose this topic is a fever headache. It's a headache for a physician, senior physician Dr. Virabhadra may be knowing. We are also dealing with a lot of patients with fever. If it gets better within a day or two, sometimes 3 days, we are happy. The patient is also happy. Fever doesn't get better, the patient finds fault with the doctor. It's not his fault. He wants to get better. It's not our fault also. So some we are seeing a lot of fevers, some viral fevers, they settle after 10 days. So very big headache, challenge for the physician. So I will be just saying why one case scenario and how do you approach a short duration fever. All these PUO, prolonged fever, everything, there are guidelines, what are the investigations to be done. Most of the PUOs will land up in a major hospital, corporate hospitals. So one of the challenges for a physician, delay in diagnosis is very important. We told about doctor patient trust usually lost. You say by 2 days you will get better, the next day you come, okay, the fever is still there, high grade fever spikes. The patient asks, "No sir, no sir, always sir." The third day you come, "No, tomorrow you will get better, don't worry." The third day also you come, the patient has high grade fever. So detailed examination with the appropriate investigations will definitely ease the diagnosis. PUO, I am not going to discuss. So this is a case, a 24-year-old software professional presented with fever for 5 days, myalgia and vomiting. Clinical examination was unremarkable except for a mild conjunctival congestion. So what should we do with this patient? It's a 5-day fever, clinical examination is nothing except for a mild conjunctival congestion. Whether you give him tablets and send him, whether you do investigations, whether you admit him. You do investigations. So whether a symptomatic treatment, investigate, admit. So we have 3 choices. It's a 5-day fever, everything is unremarkable, there is no signs, clinical signs are very minimal except for a mild conjunctival congestion. It can occur in any fever. Congenital congestion may not signify anything. So the best option should be, what is the guideline? There is no clear guidelines, it is individualized. So we have no clear guidelines how to treat a short duration fever. So it's a clinical judgment, depends on what you think. Usually it is an individualist treatment. If I feel you don't need the investigation, no problem. You know the patient for a long time. Okay, it should be viral fever. If I am very confident it is viral fever, you tell the patient, we are seeing viral fevers, you treat with all antibiotics, anti-malarials. Every investigation is normal. Suddenly after a week, patient is fine. Everything subsides. We are also clueless. So every culture, everything is negative. So could be viral fever, atypical viral fever, a lot of organisms are coming. Generally fever for more than 3 days. We have to investigate. Fever more than 3 days, better you go for investigation. Special situations, diabetic patient, immunocompromised, pregnant patients, don't wait for 5 days. So even 2 days fever, definitely go for investigations. They are immunocompromised. So the labs in this patient, the important thing I wanted to tell you, there is no substitute for a thorough clinical examination. He presented about 2 diaphragmatic hernias. It could have been clearly made out when he had a clear clinical examination doing a percussion or auscultation. That will clearly say whether it's a pleural effusion. Definitely there could have been bowel sounds. The resonance will not be dull. Definitely will not be dull in a diaphragmatic hernia. So labs reveal. So there was a hemoconcentration. Leukopenia, platelets were 78,000. So that's ESR is very non-specific. ESR, we don't work by ESR except for special situations. His LFT showed mild derangement of enzymes. Bilirubin was also mildly elevated, 1.8. MP was negative, Vidal was positive, 1 in 160. So what should be the diagnosis? So we had lab summary, I am putting again, important abnormal investigations and MP is also negative. These are the abnormal investigations in this patient. Mildly deletion liver enzymes, thrombocytopenia, hemoconcentration, leukopenia. And VIDAL is 1 in 160. The first possibility we should think of is a patient having a hemoconcentration. Hemoconcentration is very important. And thrombocytopenia with a leukopenia. Mildly elevated enzymes, bilirubin may be elevated in the condition, MP is negative. VIDAL positive, I will stress on with a single slide of what is VIDAL. So first possibility we should think is dengue fever. First possibility we should think is dengue fever. Don't think of enteric fever. So dengue fever, because the patient has hemoconcentration. Suppose the patient, same patient had a hemoglobin of 7.6 or 8.2 with a thrombocytopenia. The diagnosis is totally different. So we think of a malaria. You can think of a malaria. The same patient, hemoglobin is normal, there is leukocytosis, little bit more elevation of liver enzymes, that is 5.2 or 6.6. Leukocytosis with a thrombocytopenia. The first possibility we should think is leptospirosis. That's all. Clinical picture in initial stages can be anything, but you go by clinical decision, what would be the patient have. So first possibility you always think of a dengue fever with this picture. Leukopenia, hemoconcentration, thrombocytopenia. Malaria could be possible, but anemia is usually seen in a malaria, there is hemolysis. Enteric fever, this VIDAL test, usually the positive, that is titers become positive from the second week. And maximum titers are usually seen by the third week. So VIDAL is not very specific. Even a patient without enteric fever can have a positive VIDAL test. Others, 5-day duration fever, we don't think with this lab investigation, the first possibility you should think of a dengue fever. How should you confirm the diagnosis? The first thing we do is to prove serocitis. Serocitis is low efficient and ascites. We do a ultrasound abdomen. That will say that there is ascites, there is a pericholecystic fluid collection, there is a cholecystitis associated with A calculus. Cholecystitis is very common in dengue. And it also reveals a minimal flow efficient. That will clear the diagnosis of dengue. You can do a serology. Serology is very costly. Comes to around 500 to 600. And there is NS1 antigen is available. Now antigen tests are available. But it is not necessary in all patients. A clinical diagnosis is made. Lab is confirming. Serocitis is there. And dengue has no special treatment. Except to monitor and give fluids. The most important thing is clinical response. Suppose I feel is malaria. You have started anti-malarials. But the labs are showing totally different and the patient gets better with your anti-malarials. Don't meddle your treatment. That's very important. You always go by a clinical response. The patient is responding, don't change your line of treatment. Since what a treatment, anyway, dengue fever I told you, IV fluids and supportive treatment. And monitor for platelets. The platelets are very severe. The present recommendation less than 10,000 only we transfuse or there is evidence of bleeding. Otherwise, don't give unnecessary transfusions. You will be short of platelets. If you give for unnecessary 50,000, 40,000 and all, don't give platelet transfusions. This VIDAL test, whether the patient, I told you it's come by positive only by the third week of fever. The patient has typhoid fever, it will be positive. Titers, 1 in 320. Now the standard textbooks, major textbooks have removed VIDAL as the procedure, that is confirmatory test for a enteric fever. The confirmatory test is blood culture. Blood culture or a marrow culture, very rarely. If the patient has been immunized previously with salmonella, the patient, the VIDAL test will be positive. Most of the pediatricians now use this as a standard procedure. Everybody, if you see, all pediatricians, every 2 years or every 3 years, they give a typhoid vaccine. So all these patients will have a positive VIDAL. If you go next 5 years, most of us will, most of the younger generation will have a VIDAL positive. Cross reaction with non-typhoidal salmonella definitely can be there. Suppose it is a poorly standardized commercial antigen preparation, definitely it can be false positive. Infection, malaria and other diseases such as dengue fever can also cause a false positive VIDAL test. So don't go by viral test. Viral test always becomes significantly positive by beginning of third week. So viral is not the criteria to say it is infection. Thank you. Yes. Again, dengue, if you see, bacterial cholecystitis can be there, definitely. There will be a pericholecystic fluid collection and a very classical acalculus cholecystitis that is described with a minimal proliferation and ascites. That is confirmatory for dengue. Serocitis proven for dengue. Not all diabetic patients will have a cholecystitis.
Possible.
Acalculus cholecystitis. Without a calculus, cholecystitis.
Possible.
E. coli sepsis, GA sepsis can be possible, but with a short duration, 5 days fever, all these features with thrombocytopenia, hemoconcentration, always first possibility should be dengue.
Dengue can coexist with anything. Malaria
yes.
Can coexist.
Yes, definitely. We have seen patients dengue and malaria possible. So dengue is a common crossover infection.
Thank you for a very nice Christmas.